So today we'll be studying about theodolite. This is a very important instrument in surveying, and we'll be studying its parts, some of the major important parts, not all the parts, and we'll be studying its theory, and then I'll be giving you the practical that we would be doing for this theodolite. So okay, let's start with the parts of this theodolite. So first, from the bottom, this is the leveling head. This is called as leveling head, the entire thing. Okay, the leveling head is further divided into tribrach plates. So you can see these two plates, these are called as tribrach plates. Tri because they are mostly triangular in shape, that is the reason. Then we have these foot screws. With the foot screws you do the leveling. So I'll be showing you just in some time how those foot screws are actually used. So these foot screws are used for leveling the instrument. Okay, going on the top, the one of the major important part is this telescope. So you can see this is the telescope, and this is a different view of this theodolite. So from here we can see how this telescope is there. This is the eyepiece. Okay, so you'll be seeing from here, and on this end there'll be stadia hairs which you will be seeing. So we'll talk about the stadia hairs later on. Okay, so this is about the telescope. The telescope, you can see it is tilted in this particular image. That telescope can be rotated, or it can be with some adjustment you can rotate that telescope to take the vertical angles. So basically, what all readings a theodolite can take, let us first understand that. So a theodolite can take horizontal readings. So for example, if you are standing like this on the ground, okay, so from this point, let us say here is your instrument, from this point you can take a horizontal reading like this. So you can rotate this theodolite in a clockwise manner or in an anti-clockwise manner. So you can take a horizontal reading of almost 360 degrees. Okay, and you can take vertical reading. So from this point itself, let us say that there is something at the top. Okay, so from this point itself you can take the angle of this point, as well as you can take the angle of this point by just rotating this telescope. So you can already see that this telescope can be rotated either in a clockwise manner or in an anticlockwise manner. So that is for the taking the vertical angles. Okay, it becomes really easy if you have the instrument in front of you, but sadly due to this COVID times we are not able to get the instruments and perform the surveying practicals. Okay, anyways, so this circle that you see here, this is called as vertical circle. On this vertical circle there is this scale which will give you that how much angle you are making with this telescope. So this scale is going to give you how much angle you are making with the telescope, and you can see that there are two magnifying glasses there. These glasses are used to check these readings. Okay, this was a, now this scale is used for taking the vertical readings, vertical angle readings. What about the horizontal angle? As I told you, the theodolite is also used to take the horizontal angle. So you can see that here there is a slot. In this slot we have the horizontal scale. Okay, and then again we have a magnifying glass here. So from this magnifying glass you can see the reading of the horizontal scale. Okay, on that scale basically you are going to get the horizontal angle, that is how much you are rotating this theodolite clockwise, or how much you have rotated it anti-clockwise. So let us understand how to set up our instrument. So there are certain temporary adjustments that you have to make for getting your readings correct. So setting up is a very important process. It is basically the first process before you take the readings. So in setting up, Centering of instrument over station is marked by plumb bob or optical plummet. So basically, in surveying, what is important is that there are various points on which you need to survey. Okay, so let us say these are the points where you need to survey. So whenever you set up your instrument over these points, it is very essential that your instrument is set up exactly over that point. Because even if there is some error in setting up, those errors get accumulated over the survey, entire survey, and it may lead to a bigger error at the end. Okay, so it is very important that we eliminate such errors in the beginning itself. And the first thing that you have to do is you need to center your entire instrument exactly over this point. Now the way how it is done is that we have this plumb bob which is attached below this, exactly below this. Okay, this plumb bob is left and due to gravity that plumb bob goes straight down. Okay, so this plumb bob should be exactly, like the tip of this plumb bob should be exactly over this point. Okay, so that means that your instrument is centered at that particular position. Some instruments are provided with shifting heads which help in accurate centering. So what happens is that there is a tripod, okay, tripod. Over this your theodolite is there. Okay, I'll just draw it as a box, okay, because I don't want to waste time in that. Let us say that this is a theodolite. Below this there is a plumb bob which is hanging. Okay, let us say this is that plumb bob which is hanging. As I told you, let's say this is the point on the ground that I have marked, and as I told you that this conical shape of the plumb bob should be exactly over that point. That means that it is centered. Okay, so for that purpose, what you need to do is that you need to shift these tripod legs in order to make that plumb bob come at the center. Sometimes this becomes very cumbersome and it becomes very tiresome to keep on changing the legs of the tripod, to keep on shifting it so as to make our plumb bob centered. Alternatively, what this point says is that some instruments have got a shifting head. It means that this entire instrument itself can shift to this way, this way, this way, or this way. Okay, so what it will do, it will take the plumb bob along with it, and then instead of adjusting these tripod legs, what you can do is you can adjust the head of the instrument itself. Okay, this comes very handy when there is very slight adjustment to be done and you don't want to disturb the legs of the tripod. So in this case you can directly shift the head of the instrument itself. Tripod legs leveling. So approximate leveling is done by help of tripod legs. Moving legs radially affects the plumb bob. Moving legs circumferentially does not affect the plumb bob. This movement is therefore more effective in approximate leveling. So what this says is that, as I told you, that we have three legs of the tripod. Okay, so these three legs, like if I draw a circle around it, let us say that there can be a circle drawn around it this way. Okay, so obviously the circle is going to have a center here. So if you move any of the leg towards the center, that is you are moving the leg radially, then what it will do, then this point will be shifted either like this or like this, depending on which leg you are moving. Okay, this way or this way, and in any direction this point will get shifted. What is there on this point? On this point we have our instrument. So basically, if you are shifting the leg towards the center, you are shifting the instrument also. So basically the plumb bob now which was hanging, that will also get shifted, right? So moving leg radially will affect the plumb bob location. So the centering that you had done, I mean you, which you want to do, that can be achieved by moving the leg radially. However, if you move the leg in a circumferential direction, that is along the circumference, then this point won't move anywhere. This point will stay in its position, and thus it means that the plumb bob is not going to shift in any direction, right? So that is not going to help you in the approximate leveling. After centering the instrument approximately, the instrument is leveled using the foot screws such that the spirit level is centered. Now, after you center your instrument, these are the tripod legs, and let us say now the plumb bob, which is hanging this way, is exactly over the point of your survey, right? So you have centered the instrument, that is perfectly fine. Now, what about this instrument itself? What if the instrument is tilting like this? Okay, so for a perfect leveling, your instrument should be exactly horizontal, or it should be parallel to the it should be exactly horizontal to the surface. That is what I'm saying. Okay, so to make it horizontal, we have certain foot screws which are given. Now, in the first slide, I had shown that the leveling head of a theodolite consists of tri-brack plates, and it also has foot screws. So foot screws, when there are only three foot screws, what we have to do is that, see, there is this spirit level which I will keep along these two foot screws, this one and this one. Okay, and the first one I will rotate it anti-clockwise, the second one I'll rotate it clockwise, and I'll make sure that the spirit bubble which is there, it comes exactly at the center. Okay, so what this will make this plane to be exactly horizontal, but we still have this point which we do not know whether it is exactly horizontal or whether it is down or whether it is up. So next, what you are going to do is that you are going to keep this spirit level perpendicular to these two points, to the point, to the foot screws which you had already adjusted. You will have to keep the spirit level perpendicular to them, okay, and then you move this C such that again that bubble, it should come exactly at the center. So there are two things which you need to do here. First, you keep the spirit level parallel to these two screws, you rotate them, one you rotate clockwise, the other you rotate anti-clockwise, and you make sure that the bubble which is there in the spirit level, it comes exactly at the center mark. There is a center mark on that spirit level, it should come there. Next, you keep that spirit level perpendicular to the two screws, and then you rotate this third screw till the bubble comes exactly at the center, and now your instrument is leveled perfectly. Okay, this is what you need to do when there are three screws. What we do if there are four screws? Then when there are four screws, four foot screws are there, in that case you keep your spirit level parallel to these two, okay, and you rotate anti-clockwise, one you rotate clockwise, fine. Next, in the next operation, you keep the spirit level parallel to these two, and then you rotate, one you rotate clockwise, one you rotate anti-clockwise. So in both these cases, the bubble should come exactly at the center of the spirit level, okay, then the entire instrument will be perfectly leveled. Third is elimination of parallax. Now this is very important. Parallax is a condition arising when the image formed by the objective is not in the plane of the crosshairs. So what exactly happens is, as I told you that in the theodolite we have something called as telescope. So in the telescope you have an eyepiece. So basically you look through that telescope and you sight a particular reading. The way how a theodolite works is that reading which you are sighting, the image of that reading is formed inside the telescope. Correct. This is how basically all the telescopes work. The image of what you want to see is formed inside the telescope, and that image is what you are looking at. Correct. Now, just see that if you are sighting a staff, a vertical staff, on a vertical staff, there are many readings are there. Okay, like 1 meter, 2 meter, 3 meter, 4 meter, etc. Now, basically, the vertical staff is only of 4 meters height. So, a lot of readings are there, and you are sighting this staff through your theodolite. So, the image of this is going to be formed inside your telescope. Okay. So, now what happens is, let us say that if I draw the telescope, try to draw the telescope. So, the image which you are sighting, this is the eyepiece. From this point, you are looking from this point, and the image is somewhere, I mean the staff is held somewhere here. The image of the staff is going to be formed inside the telescope. So, let us say that the image is formed somewhere here. Okay. And there are these hairs. These are called as stadia hairs inside the eyepiece. So, let us say that position of these stadia hairs is somewhere here. So, what you will be seeing is that you will be seeing a wrong reading basically. Okay. You will be seeing this reading, whereas what you need to see is this. Okay. So, it is very important that this image is not formed anywhere else, but it is formed exactly in the plane of the crosshairs. So, the way how this is done is we need to focus the telescope. So here you can see there are some adjustments that are given to the eyepiece. So you can focus the eyepiece and you can bring the image exactly coinciding with the crosshairs. So that is what is bringing the image in the plane of the crosshairs. The way how we can eliminate errors is by repetition method. So there is not one reading that you are going to take. So for any reading, if you are taking, there has to be at least 3 readings, so that at the end the final reading would be the average of those 3 readings. Okay. So whenever you are doing surveying, you are not going to take single reading of anything. There has to be at least 3 readings. This is the way how we can remove the error. Coming on to the eyepiece now, let us see what is there inside the eyepiece. As I told you that there are cross hairs inside the eyepiece. These are called as stadia hairs, and the top one is called as top stadia, the bottom one is called as bottom stadia. The interval between them, that is the difference between the top stadia and the bottom stadia, is called as stadia intercept. It is denoted by the alphabet I. So whenever there is an image that is formed on the eyepiece, then the top stadia and the bottom stadia, this is what you need to check, that where it is coinciding with the this is the reading where it is taken, this top stadia, and this is the reading where the bottom stadia is basically coinciding, right? The difference between the top reading of the vertical staff and the bottom reading of vertical staff is called as staff intercept, and it is denoted by the alphabet S. Okay, so there are 2 things that you need to remember here. The interval between the top stadia and the bottom stadia is called as stadia intercept. The difference between the top reading and the bottom reading of the vertical staff is called as staff intercept. Let us understand the principle of measurement for the theodolite. So let us say that this is our telescope of the theodolite, which is there, and you are sighting a reading. Okay, so this is the optical center. This is the eyepiece. This is the optical center. This is our vertical staff. Let us say it is there at a certain distance. The difference between the or the interval between the top stadia and the bottom stadia is your stadia intercept, which is I, and as you know that it will be near the eyepiece itself because the top and bottom stadia are on the eyepiece. What happens is when you look at the image, your eye or the line of sight for the top stadia and for the bottom stadia. It will go straight like this, and your lens is there. Due to that, it will deviate, and these are the two, like this is the top reading and the bottom reading of the vertical staff where it intersects. So this image is now going to be formed near your eyepiece, right? What happens is, so this is the vertical stadia intercept, right? This point would be called as the focal point. The distance between the optical center and the focal point is called as focal length. The distance between the center of the instrument to the optical center is denoted by this alphabet small d, and this is the second F2, means it is the distance between the optical center and your eyepiece. The distance between the optical center and the actual object is your F1. I am calling this object because the image of this object is going to be formed inside the telescope, right? The distance between the center of the instrument to the object is denoted by capital D, and capital D is what I want to find using a theodolite, let us say. Okay, so this is what we need to determine. To determine capital D, what can it be? Like, there is a very simple formula that I can form here. Capital D is equal to F1 plus the small d. So basically, if I know how much is F1 and how much is this small d, my job is over here. My determination of the distance between the theodolite and this object is done. How to find that? So F1 upon F2 is equal to F1 upon F2 is equal to this distance divided by this distance. Okay, this can be said by this triangle. As you can see, the triangle that is formed by this green line. So if you take the similarities of the triangle, you will understand that F1 upon F2 is equal to AB, capital AB upon small AB. Capital AB is nothing but your stadia intercept. Sorry, capital AB is your staff intercept S, and small AB is your stadia intercept I. If we use the lens equation, 1 by F is equal to 1 by F1 plus 1 by F2, you will get F1 upon F is equal to 1 plus F1 by F2. Further, F1 by F is, since F1 by F2, we already know it is S by I. So F1 by F is equal to 1 plus S by I. F1 is F upon I into S plus F. Okay, so I found my F1. Now if I substitute this equation here in this equation, what I will get is F1 plus D, which is actually your capital D is equal to F1 plus D, is F by I into S plus F plus D, right? So this F by I is a constant which is denoted by K, and your F plus D is again another constant which is denoted by capital C. So for a general theodolite, K is generally 100 and C is equal to 0.25 to 0.35. It's an additive constant, and K is generally it is equal to 100. So for a theodolite, if I know K and if I know C, since these are two constants and they are going to remain same for a particular given theodolite. So if I know this K and C, now if I only find my stadia intercept, which is S, can I not find D? So see how the task becomes so simple using a theodolite, that as since I know K and C, I just have to find what is this staff intercept. Finding the staff intercept will directly give me the distance between the theodolite and the object. This is the simplicity of a theodolite, right? Now, what if you do not know this K and C? How do you find K and C if you do not know that? So, See, if you do not know K and C, that means we have two unknowns. To get two unknowns, we need to have at least two equations. So what we can do, we can put our vertical staff at a known distance d. So let us say that a distance d is known to me and I am keeping my vertical staff at that point. I will find what is the staff intercept for that. So let us say d1 is equal to k s1 plus c. This is first equation that would be formed. Second equation, again I will be shifting my vertical staff at a different distance. Again that distance would be known to me. So d2 will be k into s2 plus c. So you will be knowing d1, you will be knowing s1, d2 you will be knowing, s2 you will be knowing. There are two equations, two unknowns. You can find k and c. Once you find k and c, you can use your theodolite to find any other distance possible. Okay, so this is one of the practicals that we would be doing. I'll be giving you numericals relating to this, and you'll have to find certain unknown data. So those numericals I'll be posting in the Google Classroom. Okay, so that's it for this lecture. Till then, take care. Thank you.